Well, hi, everyone. Welcome to Framework Leadership, a podcast about principles and ideas you can use today to take your leadership to the next level. I'm your host, Ken Engel, president of Southeastern University.
And I'm your co-host, Michael Steiner, vice president for innovation and communication.
And wow, we are excited to have an amazing guest on Framework Leadership today, Dr. Aimee Franklin.
My favorite neurobiologist.
Yes. Yes.
My favorite one.
I have arrived.
Andrew Huberman. You're only my second favorite. This one's my favorite right off the top.
I feel the need to say he's probably my favorite, so then
He's my second favorite.
Dr. Franklin serves as the Dean of the College of Natural and Health Sciences here at Southeastern University. She oversees kinesiology, mathematics, natural sciences, and the nursing department. She holds a bachelor's degree in biology from SCU and a PhD in neuroscience from the University of Alabama, Birmingham. Dr. Franklin has received many, 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 many awards for Outstanding Faculty of the Year. She has a passion for mentoring and advising students, and it's always a privilege to be able to have a conversation with you, Dr. Franklin.
It's such an honor to be here. I'm super excited to talk to you both today. Always have fun when I'm here. So
yes.
We do. We look forward to it. Now, as we start our conversation, I want to ask you this. A lot of young adults are at the beginning of their careers, maybe starting internships or their first job. With that being said, I'd love to get into the neuroscience of productivity.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
How does social, let's talk about social bonding and the concept of trusting each other, trusting other people, tie into, you know, leadership roles and things like that.
No, that's great. I want to start off by setting the bar low.
Okay.
And letting
you all know
my area of expertise is synaptic physiology and learning and memory and then the hippocampus. So I'm just going to throw out big words to sound impressive. Point is, this is not my specific area, but as a neuroscientist, I do have a lot of thoughts on this and some experience in
so
this area.
So we should attach a definition of terms to this podcast.
Correct. Yes. Okay. The appendix in the show notes
will be there.
I'll be happy to provide those. Yeah. So I'll start with what you first said about neuroproductivity.
Yes.
And so we everybody's always wants to do better and how can we get our brains to be more productive and what can we do? So there are actually like three hormones, neurotransmitters in the brain. So neurotransmitters are chemical messengers that allow neurons to talk to each other. So if you're a neuron and you're a neuron and I'm a neuron and we all need to communicate, we actually don't directly touch one another. We send signals to each other, and those signals are what are called neurotransmitters. Mm. A lot of popular ones that people have probably heard of are dopamine, serotonin, that type of thing. So there are three neurotransmitters that neurons use to communicate that are really essential for productivity in the brain. And those three, the first one is dopamine. Mm. Most people are familiar with that. That's a feel-good hormone.
Right.
So you get a dopamine release anytime you do something that feels good. Now, most people are familiar with dopamine in regards to addiction, drugs of abuse. So any drugs of abuse can hijack the system, that's why it feels good, and then you become addicted to that feel-good feeling. But dopamine in regards to productivity, we can actually use that. So
right.
So what I do in my own personal life is you can – anytime I have tasks to do, I always make a checklist first thing because the physical act of checking off a list gives you a dopamine release.
Exactly.
Love it.
So,
you
know, first thing on the list, make a list. Done.
Yeah.
So I also encourage students to do this all the time, especially when you have a lot of assignments. Do make a list because you actually get a neurochemical reward from most individuals. I don't want to generalize to everyone. Most individuals get a reward from checking off a list. So that's kind of the feel good. When you're doing something you enjoy, it's really easy to be productive because you're getting that dopamine release. When you're doing a task that you don't necessarily enjoy, you have to manufacture rewards. Like if I have a 20-page paper due and I write 5 pages, I get to take a break and watch my favorite Netflix show that I get to binge. So you create rewards in a task you don't want to do. And another thing with dopamine, that can increase productivity is you get a dopamine release from social media, from seeing likes on Instagram, from Twitter. So if you're trying to be productive, you need to remove things from your area that are going to give you a bigger dopamine release than that checklist is. Mm-hmm. So me personally, I love some very limited reality TV on Netflix. Sure. I won't say which one. But I can't have that show playing in the background when I'm trying to get something done, because I'll get a bigger dopamine release from watching that show than I will from the task at hand. So that's one way to kind of increase productivity. The second hormone, so there's dopamine, and then there's noradrenaline or norepinephrine. Yeah. And this is a neurotransmitter that's released in response to stress, fight or flight. When you see a bear, are you going to run from it? Are you going to fight it? Or are you going to freeze is actually the third response. But most people think of stress as being a bad thing, but a little bit of stress is actually good. Right. It's good for your brain, and it's good for focus and good for attention. This is oftentimes why procrastinators get stuff done, because their sympathetic response kicks in because the deadline's in an hour and they're able to get a lot done because you get this hyper focus from the sympathetic response. You can't perpetually be in that state where it's negative on your brain and negative on your system, but a little stress is good, a lot of stress is bad. So that's norepinephrine. So giving yourself deadlines. So not wait. So tricking your brain into thinking you have a deadline. I do this all the time. The deadline's in a month. I tell myself I have to have a quarter of it done by next week, and give yourself these. And so then you can procrastinate safely within the system and get a little safe bump in norepinephrine or noradrenaline. The third hormone is acetylcholine. This hormone... I keep saying hormone. You guys correct me, man. You guys are card-carrying neuroscientists now. You got to hold me accountable.
Right.
The third neurotransmitter is acetylcholine, and this one is involved in learning and memory and attention and focus. It's also involved in how we move our muscles when we flex our muscles. Yeah. It's through acetylcholine. Acetylcholine is essential in the region of the brain, hippocampus, where I was talking about. It's involved in, again, learning, memory, completing task. There's actually a deficit of acetylcholine in a lot of neurodegenerative disorders like Alzheimer's disease. So natural ways of boosting acetylcholine, one of them is through light activity or light exercise. So taking a walk, it actually increases BDNF, which can help boost acetylcholine. Mm-hmm. BDNF is a neurotrophin called brain-derived neurotrophic factor. So one way to do it is to be physically healthy, but also before starting a task where you need to be productive, take a 20-minute brisk walk. Doing an intense workout can actually be detrimental to attention and production. So starting your morning with a 20-minute brisk walk, remove all distractions when you start the task, give yourself little deadlines, reward yourself. Those are all ways to maybe increase neuroproductivity. Mm-hmm. The second part of your question, you guys are going to learn I'm a little long-winded, so you got to cut me off when I talk too much science.
Listen,
I think talked about, the question was about social bonding in regards to leadership. Yeah. So this is an interesting topic that I've recently become interested in as a new leader. You mentioned I was the dean of the College of Natural Health Science. This is new. I'm just completing my first year, so I've really started thinking about leadership more strategically and what I want to do. And I've recently learned that social interactions are extremely important for leadership. I mean, intuitively, we know that. The people have to like you to follow you. They're not going to follow you if they don't like you. Right. They don't trust you. But in relationships, when we form relationships with people, we can actually release this hormone, and this one's an actual hormone called oxytocin. And oxytocin is, we like to think of it, most people are familiar, if they've heard of oxytocin, it's in childbirth. So oxytocin is actually what stimulates childbirth. In fact, if anyone's ever been induced, a lot of people have heard of it. Pitocin is a synthetic form of that. So that's a way to induce labor is Pitocin. Yeah. So oxytocin is popular for when you're thinking about childbirth and breastfeeding, because it actually stimulates lactation. So, but what we're beginning to appreciate is oxytocin is released in men, and they're not bearing children and breastfeeding, but oxytocin is also very much a social hormone. It's a feel good hormone. Mm-hmm. When you have good positive social connections, you release oxytocin. So why is that important in regards to leadership? There are several studies that show that when you give oxytocin, and you can actually do it in a nasal spray, and you take a group and you give some of them a placebo spray with they're getting nothing, some of them oxytocin in their nose, they are more likely to go along with a charismatic leader if they have an oxytocin boost.
Wow.
So this is interesting, because what it means is if you're a charismatic leader, those that get a release of oxytocin around you will be more likely to follow you and more likely to believe what you say. So the question is, how do we get the people that are following us to have oxytocin? Mm-hmm. So I made a joke earlier when I was talking to someone. There are things called nicotine toothpicks. Maybe we start handing out nicotine oxytocin, oxytocin toothpicks to everyone following us. I don't think manipulation is the way to do it. It's actually quite the opposite true. How oxytocin is released when we interact with people is through trust and positive interactions. Mm-hmm. So if you want your team to follow you and without manipulation, you need to be authentic and time spent with the people that you're wanting to believe in you and trust you is one of the biggest factors. There's also an oxytocin release when you share a meal. Food actually causes an oxytocin release. So there's something to be said about eating together, communing together, and building that natural trust. And then people will, when they see you, get an oxytocin release. Right. So when you ask them to do something, they're more inclined to say yes. And it's all, not all due, but it can be due to these hormones being released. Yeah. So, there's a flip side of that because that can be manipulated.
Right.
So in with that knowledge, this is also why a lot of people follow charismatic leaders down bad paths.
Right.
Because they're getting these release of these hormones and more likely to follow something they normally otherwise would not. We can cognitively override this, but sometimes we don't.
Right.
So I actually, in learning this, and I've had this sign in my office this whole year, but I have a sign in my office that actually says character over charisma to make sure that your character matches the level of charisma that you have, because if not, you're going to do something nefarious with the people that are following you.
Right.
And now there's a scientific explanation as to why and how that happens.
Yeah, this one study I was hearing about on the Huberman Lab podcast, they talked about how when somebody is tagged as your person, and that's the phrase they use. This is my people.
Right.
We are all the same people. When somebody's tagged like that in your brain, just seeing them on the street, just walking past them, releases the oxytocin on that side of it. And that's how powerful this kind of, I mean, it's really, it gets back to like tribalism, right? Like this is, you know, we like to find our people, who's our tribe, and kind of collect around that. And then this forms the social bond right there.
Right. So married couples that live together have higher levels of baseline levels of oxytocin. It's oftentimes called the love hormone, not necessarily the attraction hormone, but the love hormone, that feeling of safety, security. And so if you want to build that in the people that are following you, you need to be someone who's safe, and they need to have experiences with you that then lead to oxytocin release, and then they will follow you.
And the study he was talking about, the other one he said was on shared experiences specifically, they did this one study where they had everybody hear the same narrative story, and they had them hear it in different times and at different locations and all the different stuff. But their dopamine releases and their oxytocin releases synced with the narrative story, because the narrative is the way that we communicate and became and all that kind of stuff. So this idea that shared narrative, shared values is another way to kind of accelerate that social bonding. If you know that me and you value the same thing and have a common story, working here at Southeastern tags us as a people.
Right. There's also a negative side to that in that those we don't have shared experiences with, we're less likely to listen to their beliefs. So it kind of is one of the things that kind of drives division as well. Mm-hmm. So while there's a positive to it, there's a flip side. So it kind of gives you this in-group versus out-group mentality as well. So there's positive, but it can there can always be downsides or nefarious sides to it.
So if you think about it as a leader, your goal is then to, you know, if you're a leader that wants to get through division, what you got to do is communicate to the people that have tagged you as their leader that shared story. How can I tell stories about these other group that maybe you didn't like? Bring them in and create those.
And have to prove yourself trustworthy. Mm-hmm. And you build that oxytocin shared experience through positive interactions.
Yeah.
It always has to be positive, more positive experiences than negative.
Love it.
So yeah, it's...
Wow. It's fascinating. I want to change the subject a little bit and talk about your experience here at Southeastern. How did your education really set you up for your current success and ultimately impact your life, change your life?
Yeah, so I'm finishing my 8th year as a faculty member here at Southeastern, and I was a student here for 3.5 years. So nearly almost half of my life has been spent in connection with Southeastern. Mm-hmm. As a student, my experiences here were phenomenal. The academic education that I received set me up for success in graduate school. I did not feel overwhelmed. So academically, I was completely prepared. But to be honest, I think the majority of universities could have prepared me academically for graduate school. What was different about my experience here at Southeastern were the relationships with the faculty. They taught me how to, through example, how to mentor with appropriate boundaries, how to inspire, how to lead, and how to live out their faith, and how to question their faith, and that's okay. And so really what drew me back to Southeastern was the faculty. Mm-hmm. And now I have an opportunity for the last 8 years to work with them and now be in a position of leadership. And it's truly incredible, because it's the relationships that drew me back. And my goal is that we have students who, I don't necessarily want them all to come back. I want them to go change the world, but to have that same experience when they leave here, to say, okay, I feel prepared academically, but so much more than that, as a whole person, I feel prepared to navigate the world in my chosen career.
And you had amazing opportunities when you graduated, you know, that you could have taken that mention a couple of those.
So when I finished graduate school, I had several postdoc research opportunities, and I was almost took a couple, and I have students ask me all the time if I regret not taking them. And if I can be transparent, I'm sitting here with my bosses, I'll be transparent about, I'd be lying if I said there weren't times, I tell students this all the time. I'd be lying if I said I'd never said, oh man, I could be running a big lab somewhere. Sure, could be Andrew Huberman, maybe.
You will be by the time we're done with this podcast.
I need a glow up, though. Right. I'm going to need some
we'll
work.
We'll work on it. Okay. No, you look great on camera. But, you look better than he does on camera, let's be honest.
On the off chance he listens to this, I think you look great, Andrew Huberman. I think I would have been happy in those opportunities. I really do. I think I would have been fulfilled. But what I get in my interaction with students, and I tell them this story. When I was a student here, I was sitting in chapel one day, and the chapel speaker was talking about how the conversion of Saul to Paul was you know, so important, and we get Paul, the greatest missionary we've ever had. And if Saul didn't go through that conversion, we might not have the Christian faith all over the world like we do. But what most people don't talk about in that story was Ananias, and how it was his obedience that allowed for the conversion of Saul to Paul. And the speaker that day at the end said, you know, some of you in this room will be a Paul and you're going to be a world changer, but some of you are going to be an Ananias and you're going to be the one that trains and equips the Pauls of the world. And so I thought I was going to be a Paul, but I actually am so glad and feel like my true calling is being an Ananias and mentoring those students who are going to go out and change the world and raising a generation of Paul scientists and nurses and exercise physiologists. So while I did have opportunity, and I do think about that, I think I could have been happy doing that. I believe in our divine design and our calling. I think so many people think it's such a specific, narrow thing, but my belief, and I tell students this all the time, that God gave you gifts, talents, and abilities, and he wants you to use those for his glory. And as long as you're doing that, you kind of have some freedom. My choice was to come here, and I haven't regretted it since. So.
And one of the coolest things I think you're doing right now with our students that maybe not a lot of people hear, but I'd love for our listeners to hear more about is you started an undergraduate neuroscience research lab or projects with our students on campus. Tell us a little bit about this project. What are you doing with it? What are we hoping to accomplish? And what are the students working on right now?
Yeah, so you asked me my experience here, and I said I was academically prepared, but I'll be honest, when I went to graduate school, I'd never stepped foot in a research lab. Mm. So while I was crushing my didactic lectures, I had never been in a research lab. So when I did come back, I said, if I come back, I want to start a research lab. I want to do undergraduate neuroscience research. And the university has been nothing but supportive and said, okay, what do you need? So I was able to buy some equipment and form some collaborations so that we can get animal tissue. And because I wanted students, I know they're going to be prepared academically, I wanted them to have experiential learning as well. And so out of that, we now have three research labs. I have a neuroscience research lab where we have collaborations where other labs provide us with mouse and rat brain tissue and our students do experiments on those. We have an organic synthesis research lab where they're looking at novel ways to synthesize Parkinson's therapeutic drugs. Wow. We also have a more biological lab where it's looking at using diatoms to produce fossil fuels.
Wow.
So basically algae is a way to produce fuel.
Sure.
And
yeah.
So that's all being done here. In addition to the collaborations we have where we send students other places, like Lakeland Regional, where we have the clinical research internship. So that was a big non-negotiable when I came here, is I want to be here, I want to change, you know, I want to be that influence on students' lives that I had, but I also want to bring research with me. Mm-hmm. And it also gives me the opportunity to still dabble in it a little
right.
bit.
And keep up with it.
Keep my toes in the water. So.
Love it.
That's good.
So, yeah. Love it. And it's so exciting. And I think we're going to... probably by the time this podcast airs, it'll be later this fall or early spring. We're working on some more content for you guys to hear about this different stuff the students are working on from themselves. So I'm excited about
it's
launching
so exciting.
That. Yeah.
And out of those research labs, almost every student, and I should have the numbers off the top of my head, is either in a PhD program or in medical school.
Mm-hmm.
Almost every student that has come through our labs.
Well, you think about the kingdom impact that that's going to have, right?
Right?
To have people that, as you say all the time, integrate their faith, their learning, their life into the medical field, going out with that. They have those hats and all that kind of thing.
Right. And that's the goal of the program, is to produce, you know, Jesus-loving professionals. And that's what we need. Yeah.
Yeah. And speaking of that, you know, overall with your experiences here at SCU, you have integrated your education with your faith. And with that being said, we would really love to dive into the concept of faith and science, you know, intertwined. A lot of people say you can't have both, and there's a clear divide between the two. But how do you combat those claims? And how does science inform faith and vice versa?
Yeah. That's a great question. And again, I'll answer transparently in that I had some trouble in graduate school. I came to Southeastern. I'm a pastor's kid. I was raised in church, and I had a great education here. I was kind of surrounded by great religion professors and great chapel services. And when I got to graduate school and kind of learned about neuroscience, and there were some things that kind of rocked me a little bit and caused me to question and doubt, and I had to work through that, but what I came out on the other side of that is question and doubt is exactly what makes faith authentic.
Right.
If you don't test it, if you don't question it, is it even yours? Mm. So I think the two actually go hand in hand. Albert Einstein, and some argue that this quote is taken out of context, but I'll still share it, that Albert Einstein actually says that science without religion is lame. And religion without science is blind.
Hmm.
So you actually you need the two. And and I love when religion, or I actually hate calling it religion, when relationship with Jesus is found in science. I actually love listening to a lot of podcasts like Michael does. And I love listening to secular podcasts and hearing scientific conclusions that back up biblical foundations.
Right.
This idea of leadership and causing an oxytocin release in spending time and sharing meals, that's exactly what Jesus did with his disciples.
Right.
He spent time, he was authentic, he was trustworthy, he shared meals with them. So of course they followed. So it's we see that we see these scientific concepts. The idea that the brain is plastic and that we can change it. You know, there's a scripture in the New Testament that talks about renewing our mind daily. That's a scientific thing that happens. So I don't think the two are at odds. And if they ever are, it's okay. I think that as Christians, sometimes we like to put God in a box because we have this need to understand and this need to be able to predict an outcome. But we don't need to put him in this box. And I don't ever find them at odds. And when they are, it'll be worked out. We just haven't found the rest of the data yet. So we're always discovering new. So I actually, because of my experience of kind of leaving the bubble and really running into some doubts and some questions, I actually really encourage my students to start questioning here, where there's safe places to go for answers. And in my neuroscience class, I ask them, I don't want to say controversial questions, but really say, well, why do you believe that? Do you really believe that?
Right.
Well, you really believe that verse? Why? And force them to come to question it. So then when they come back home, they know that's their belief and not the belief of their parents or their professors.
Yeah. Yeah. So when you're walking them through those students, you know, what are some other ways you're preparing them for that real life, right? When things are coming in, and how do you coach them on coming back, or is there coming back? Walk us through what that process looks
like. Yeah. For better or worse, I always say when you're making decisions, you make the best decision you can with the data available. And so data never scares me. So I show students data. And if it's controversial to maybe what we believe, we say, here's this data. Now come to a conclusion. Mm. But as we gather more data, your conclusion may have to change. Mm-hmm. I kind of teach students that process. Of course, I tell them there are some absolute truths that aren't going to change, right, that are ever mm-hmm. constant. But a lot of the things that we argue about and bicker about in politics and in faith, the more data we get, we kind of, and I hate to use the word evolve, but our opinions and interpretations kind of evolve. So I kind of force students to be exposed to all sides of an argument, right, and not be afraid of the other side, and not be afraid for discussion, and not be afraid of those things. So, because that's what's going to be necessary in the real world mm-hmm. to communicate. Not everyone, when you leave Southeastern or when you leave your bubble, your group, most people are not going to have the same opinions on you as you about everything. So yep. you have to be able to see things from other people's perspectives, right, and be able to understand. So.
Love it.
Yeah, so good. So powerful. Man, great conversation. We could literally do a series of conversations with
Sign
you.
Sign me up.
And
Sign
we will.
And we yeah. will. Yeah. We'll have to do that. Yeah. We're going to move into our fire round.
All right,
and
I'm ready.
You know what that's all about. Ask you a few questions surrounding a little bit of everything we discussed. And we just want that, you know, first thought that comes and give it to us. So we want to grab some good practical and applicable pieces of advice for all of our listeners. So, Michael, mm-hmm. fire away.
Love it. What is the number one way leaders can build trust on their teams?
I would say time, mm-hmm. time, investing time with the people you're leading, cool. and authenticity.
Yeah.
So, number two things.
Two things.
Tied, 1A, 1B.
Yeah. And with that,
and food,
have a meal.
Food. Eat,
and
yeah.
lots of meal.
Eat chocolate.
Eat.
Yes. Chocolate.
Dark
cake.
Chocolate.
Yes. Dark chocolate.
Right.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. Love it.
That's another podcast.
Yeah. Dark chocolate, aphrodisiacs, anything
yes.
that
oh,
produces.
Oh, hey. Yeah. I didn't touch this oxytocin connection
that's
since you brought it up.
Right
yeah, that's
there.
The next podcast.
There it is. Yeah, the sex podcast.
Yeah.
Coming this fall.
I do a series on it with students.
That's
so
right, you do,
I'm
it's a very popular series.
Happy to talk about it. Yeah,
love it.
What are some tips for our graduates who are navigating post college life?
Yeah, that's a good one. This is what I tell students who I advise: have a plan, have a long term goal, but don't be so locked into your long term goal that you miss opportunities that are right in front of you. So I tell students to focus on the next right step.
Yeah, that's good.
You can't be so focused on you need to have goals. So when I was a student here, my goal was med school. But the next right step for me when I left here, I got an invitation to apply to a PhD program. So I took that next right step. And so I was still working towards a goal.
Sure. Yeah.
But don't miss the opportunities that are in front of you just because you're so focused on what you think is the end goal.
Well
so
said.
next right step is all you can do. You can't worry about 10 steps.
Love it. Love it. Last question. If I am needing to learn something as quickly as possible, and this is...
Cocaine. No, I'm just kidding. I'm just kidding. That was a joke. That was a joke. Joke.
Leave that one in there, guys. Don't cut that one out.
Edit that one out.
Don't cut that one out. Leave that. That's gold. That's the best soundbite. No. If I need to learn something as quickly as possible, not just the fact, but also how to do it, what's the best way to do that?
That's an impossible question to answer because everybody has different learning styles.
Okay.
So it would depend on your learning style.
Got it.
For me, cram at the last minute and repeat. But that might not be your learning style. And what I've learned in my 8 years of teaching is students learn different ways. We all learn different ways. So figure out the way you learn mm-hmm. and then get good at it.
Love it.
That's great. Man, fascinating conversation. And again, we could talk for a long, long time. Great stuff.
Yeah.
You're an amazing professor. We are grateful
Thank you
are in the classroom mm-hmm. and teaching.
It's my favorite place to be.
Teaching these amazing students that God sends our way. But more importantly, you've become an amazing leader as dean. And you've just, as you mentioned, completed your first year. But already we see the effects of your leadership and the way you are leading the College of Natural Health Sciences.
Thank you so much for saying that. I'm having fun. I'm having fun. And I'll be back next year.
That's right. Yeah, that's exactly right. You signed that contract.
Signed that contract. Signed it. So.
That's good. If you want to stay up to date with Dr. Franklin, you can follow her on Instagram at Dean_Franklin_SEU.
Is that correct? Oh, yep.
All right. Got that right.
Love it. Perfect. Love it. And for more leadership content, check us out on Instagram at Kent_Engel, at Dr. Michael Steiner. Or if you want to follow Dr. Engel on Twitter, check him out at Kent Engel. If you're watching us on YouTube right now and you loved this episode like I did, I want you to hit that like button, hit that subscribe button so you get more leadership content in your YouTube feed every single week. Never miss an episode. You can also visit our website, kentengel.com. Sign up for our leadership newsletter. This is where we have the best news, the best topic, the best picks that you have for leadership content right to your inbox every single week. Thank you so much for listening to Framework Leadership.
Take care, everybody.